Welcome to Rockland Psychiatric Center's Community Mental Health Scope. With this program, we hope to make you, our viewers, more aware of the vision and mission of Rockland Psychiatric Center, which is hope, respect, and recovery for those with severe and complex mental illnesses, and also to make you more aware of the programs in our community which are of value to us all. I'm your host, Don Pasquale. Today we have with us somebody who's going to tell us about something that I think we all should know about, caregiving. We have Christine Sotmuri, who's a professional caregiver advocate from Hudson Valley Medical Center here in Peekskill, and she's going to tell me about something that's important to all of us. Welcome, Christine.
Thank you. Thank you.
And go ahead. What is a caregiver as opposed to a caretaker?
Oh, I think it's just a different use of the same word. I've heard caretakers sometimes referred to as someone who takes care of children, maybe, but. Mm-hmm. But like a nanny or something.
Like a nanny.
But caregiver has become the most common term that's used for mostly family members, and also neighbors now are taking care of each other. And so it's right. When someone's frail or sick or disabled is usually what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. And for most of the caregivers, we're talking about over a long period of time. So
now, your title is professional advocate. Now, do you work for the hospital, or are you separate? Are you a liaison, or what's your connection with what you do?
What I did 2 years ago is I went to the hospital and I proposed that we have a caregiver program for Hudson Valley Hospital so that we could reach out into the community and help some of the families that have gone home from the hospital or maybe come in periodically for checkups and different things. And so they thought it was a great idea. So I'm not employed by the hospital, but I work through them. We get grants, and I work through the Hudson Valley Hospital Foundation. And so I've been able to create some of these programs.
So it's not necessarily for those people who have been in the hospital, but for the community at large, is
yes,
that what you
said? Yes, that's right. We're really open to all caregivers. So it can be people who are taking care of someone with mental illness. It can be someone taking care of a child with autism. Or mostly what we get is people taking care of seniors, maybe a spouse, maybe a parent, if they have like the earlier stages of dementia or Alzheimer's, things like that. We've had some people come in, their loved one has had a stroke. So it's... What we do is we find enough in common that the caregivers have a chance to support each other and to share what their stories are.
Mm-hmm. As an advocate, specifically, what do you do?
I create programs that were not there before. And that's really, and I also educate people as to the complexity of caregiving. I think what people think is that somehow, I was speaking to a deacon the other day at All Saints Church. We had done an event down there, and she said, oh, even with the church, we think of if someone first gets a diagnosis, we give them a food basket and we'll put them on the prayer list. And if someone's died, we give them another, you know, food basket or a dinner or something, and then we put them on the prayer list. She said, but I didn't realize for all the years and years and years that someone's taking care of someone, the church doesn't really do anything for those people. And they're going to start to create a program now where they're going to have volunteers from the church go and maybe read to the loved ones so that the caregiver can go get their hair done or go shopping or take a break, you know. So everyone's thinking of new programs now, not just me, but I'm the advocate part of me is creating mm-hmm. the conversation.
Okay, so in essence, what you're saying, the definition of the caregiver as far as we're concerned or as far as the church is concerned was somebody in the family or church or...
Or a neighbor.
Or a neighbor.
Yep.
So what is your definition of caregiver can be? Who? Anybody?
Yeah, it can be. There are several layers of it. So the most important caregiver that everyone worries about is the person who's living with the person who needs the care day in and day out, 24/7. They don't have a break. There's no relief. Family maybe isn't nearby or anything. That's the primary caregiver.
Right.
Then the secondary caregivers are all the people that come in and give them a break or worry about the primary caregiver and the patient. So now you've got someone worried about two people. those people who are secondary caregivers, I don't think give themselves enough credit because they think, oh, I'm not the caregiver. It's my mom who's taking care of my dad. But all the children really are secondary caregivers because they're worried about their mom's health. Maybe she's getting run down. They're worried about the dad who has the early stages of dementia, let's say. And so now you have all these secondary caregivers. So that's why I call it family wellness when I do some of we have family wellness workshops. Mm-hmm. And because really it's the whole family that needs to be involved.
Well, who do you advocate to on behalf of the primary or on behalf of the secondary? Or
anybody who needs the help.
Do you stand in and then do you say, well, you know, I think your father needs to, you know, a day off or something. Do you facilitate getting somebody while the father goes out and plays golf for a day for somebody to take over those responsibilities for the particular person you're talking about?
What I do is I'm instrumental in creating programs like that. So like a volunteer program. Mm-hmm. We had a high school program for a little while and the kids were going to go in and, you know, maybe write Christmas cards for the caregiver.
Okay.
Or decorate the house or something. Okay. Where it would be something that, or shop or pick up, you know, mm-hmm. something at the store or something like that. Because some of the high school kids can drive already and stuff. So what I would, you know, what I try to do is as many opportunities as I can find to start the ball rolling, then I don't necessarily stay and run the whole program.
Yeah.
But I keep steering people away from only thinking about the patient. My mission is to think about the patient and the caregiver. So that's why I call it the family.
Mm-hmm.
So even at the hospital, when they mostly focus on the patients,
right.
I'm expanding their concept to say a stressed out family who is supporting that particular patient is not creating health at home for the patient to be released into their care. We need to make sure those caregivers are healthy, happy, getting the rest they need, getting the nutrition they need, getting the respite they need, so that then when the patient comes home to them, they're actually happy to see them and able to give the kind of care that's been demanded of them.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't have people who are burnt out in your community left to their own devices with no support. So really an advocate, what I've been doing is gathering the community in all its different facets to say, let's support these people who are doing such a good job. I mean, they're really...
And how do you support them specifically? We're not talking about the patient, though. We're talking about the caregiver.
The family.
The family. What do you do? How do you educate them? Or how do you...
Well, it's that's why you can't lump... First of all, you can't lump all caregivers together. They
right.
all have different needs.
Right.
So what I've done is I've tried to create so many programs on so many different levels that address so many of their needs that maybe caregiver A will come to this program, but caregiver B will go to this other program. So an example would be if somebody wants the support of a group and feels comfortable talking about their situation in a group, we have family wellness workshops all over the county. So I just came from one down in New Rochelle. We have them in Briarcliff. We have them in Peekskill. We have them, you know, all around this local area, Ossining.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's a group situation. Some people don't feel comfortable being in a group.
Right.
So then what I've done is I've tapped into the county program. They have community coaches that are assigned to people over the phone. So you might meet with the caregiver once in person just to, you know, make face contact. And then after that, every week, every 2 weeks, once a month, whatever the caregiver wants, the coach checks in. And that can be information that they need. They might need a phone number. They might need moral support. They might need to just vent. They might need to celebrate something that was great. So the coach will help them do that. Then you have other programs where there are coaches actually in the hospital. So now you have, even down the Bronx, they have Montefiore has that program, White Plains Hospital has that program, Northern Westchester, and we're talking about bringing it also here to Hudson Valley Hospital, where you have coaches in the hospital as people are going through crisis, they talk to the families.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it depends on what somebody, we have lots of education. So you might, one time you might have a 1 day event with lawyers coming in and supporting the caregivers and saying what all the issues are. The next time you might have a financial person come in and talk to the caregivers about how do you plan and how do you, you know, protect your assets and things like that. The next time it might be a social worker. What if you need services and you don't even know where to start? Like maybe you'd need adult daycare. Most people don't even know what adult daycare is.
Mm-hmm.
They thought it was just for children. So there's mm-hmm. so many things. So a social worker would explain all the different programs. What's the difference between a retirement home, assisted living, and a nursing home, and even a rehabilitation facility? Those are four different... You can't just say, I'm going to put my loved one in a home anymore. You have four different levels. What do you need? Well, you need to talk to a social
worker.
Do
you provide education for all these?
No, I bring people in for all that.
You bring people in for all that.
Like I'll create the program, or I'll partner with people who are creating the program. Elder Serve has been wonderful. They partner with me. They're down in Yonkers, but we'll do events together. We're doing one tomorrow. So it's called Putting Your House in Order. So there's like all these different programs that we're trying to have people.
Tell me something about that, Putting Your House in Order. Like what are the particular aspects of that program?
A lot of it's about documents. It's a lot about the things that people don't want to talk about. I call them icky topics. People don't want to talk about do not resuscitate orders, or power of attorneys, or wills, or funeral planning. And so we're having...
Now, the people are not the patient. The people are the caregivers.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
So they would learn about all the different repercussions. If you do it this way, if you, you know, form a trust, if you do it this way, you know, so, you know, reverse mortgages, all these different concepts that some caregivers have never heard of before. And it helps to, you know, save... Save the homestead. You know, there are ways of saving money for your children. There's ways of, you know, some people need to apply for Medicaid and they don't even know how to do it.
How do you know when you're not overloading people with all this information?
We only do one subject at a time. So one day they'll come for one thing. Or they've actually, the county's also been having on the phone, you can call in to a teleconference. And so I forget when the date for that is, but that's coming up. And it'll just be one topic. And one of the topics that we've been talking about recently is respite. How do you get a break? If you're overwhelmed, if you're burnt out, how do you get a break? So that's...
Okay, tell me what your formula is. Obviously, since you've been involved in this, what is your way of helping the caregiver get a break?
Each caregiver is different.
But
so for some people, it's a matter of having 20 minutes a day where somebody will come in and while maybe their loved one is taking a nap, they can go out and take a quick walk. For other people, they need a longer break. So maybe for a whole weekend, they'll be able to hire an aide to come in. Or maybe someone for church will come in for an afternoon and read to their loved one while they, and this could be even a child with autism or other disabilities. You can, you know, maybe if you're a teacher, you could know how to keep the kid entertained and busy while the mom or the dad goes off and does just some of the little banking things that people need to do. So that's that kind of break, you know. Then there are other more serious ways of getting respite, which would be that you can actually put your loved one in a nursing home for a week. And you can go and be with the rest of your family for that wedding in California or for the family reunion in Florida. People don't realize that when you're a caregiver, you're pretty much grounded. You're not able to travel. So that kind of respite is also available.
Now, you mentioned that's very interesting. Do people know about this? I mean, does a patient want to go, say, from his or her home to a nursing home for a week while the while the children go off on a vacation, so to speak?
Right. What confused me was that I took care of my husband for 8 years. He had Alzheimer's. And what I would think was through his eyes, what did he want? And that meant when I thought through his eyes, what did he want, I didn't ask for help for about 5 or 6 years. I did it all by myself because I thought he wouldn't want to do that. What now I understand is that the professionals in the home or the professionals in the adult daycare know what to say to somebody who doesn't want to be there. They know how to get them involved. They know how to entertain them. They know how to get them distracted, if you will, so that you can go off and take your break. And they are professional. They know they've heard it all before. So what you're really doing is you're handing your loved one over to professionals.
Right.
And when you talk about mental health, that's exactly what they are specialists in.
Right. Do you know any of these mechanisms, for example? Something that you know from experience?
Like, for instance, when it was my husband, if he would keep saying, "When's my wife coming back? When's my wife coming back? Where is she? Where's my wife coming back?" If he would say that for the 5 hours he was in adult daycare, they didn't feel the pressure of those questions the way I would.
Right. The behavior didn't change, but the audience did, in a sense.
Exactly. Okay. So they, when he would say, "Where's my wife? Where's my wife? Is she coming back?" And you know, "Of course she is. Now, why don't you come over and look at this drawing that we had? You know, we know you like to draw. Oh, let's listen to this music together until she gets back." And then they would comfort him. And before you know it, he had forgotten to ask the question. And then maybe in a half hour, "Oh, where's my wife?" You know, but when it's your loved one, it really is much, much harder because you're not a professional, you know, to deal with some of this.
You know, that reminds the story, not the story, but Sandra Day O'Connor, the retired Supreme Court judge, went through the same thing with her husband the adult home.
Yeah.
And he became interested in a female patient there. And she completely understood, you know.
Yeah, my husband had a girlfriend in the nursing home just for a short while. Then I went back the next time and they said, "Oh, they broke up." But somehow, you know, it's funny now, but somehow you just adapt to it because the whole thing is...
And you understood the situation,
Yeah. And I actually made friends with her, so...
So you said, "You better leave my husband alone,
Yeah. You better watch yourself.
Now, how do you have an active recruitment of caregivers? Are you involved in that or what?
What we were talking about today at the group this morning, the one of the women that came who her husband, I deal with former caregivers as well. You should know that.
Okay.
Because what happens is...
Because of their experience that they can
hand on? Yes, because when people come to the groups, what we don't focus on so much is that they lost their husband or they lost their child. Mm-hmm. We focus on what was it like to be their caregiver for the 4 years while they were sick. Mm-hmm. So they can share as much about that as the people who are doing it right now. So I do invite former caregivers to come. Mm-hmm. So this woman was a former caregiver. Her husband had only died back in February, so she had taken care of him for 4 years. Mm-hmm. And then she was saying that it's really a matter of her son stepping in, the fact that she was going to the nursing home every single day, and she started losing weight, and her complexion was changed. Her son dragged her literally in her car to the senior center. He paid for her membership. And from that point on, she had a whole support system. So now what she was doing is she was going to the senior center before the nursing home for 3 or 4 hours. Then she would go to the nursing home. Or she would go to the nursing home in the morning and then come to the senior center in the afternoon. And she said it changed everything to have the kind of support and have other people to talk to. Mm-hmm. And she wasn't alone anymore. Whereas before, but really it was her son who brought her. So I highly recommend not asking the caregiver to come. I ask the secondary caregivers or people who are worried about the caregivers, bring them and take them with, you know, the two of you come.
Mm-hmm. Initially, my thought is that the initial caregiver feels a sense of guilt. Oh, I must stay here. I must care for this person and doesn't want to leave the environment.
They call it caregiver syndrome. Mm-hmm. There's actually, and it's not a diagnosis, but it's people have
describes
observed.
What it is.
Yeah, that people have observed. Another thing I try to do is get caregivers when they're first starting out. So if someone has just been diagnosed, it's way better to get them in a group or get them into all these programs. If you wait until they're a little bit more isolated, then you're right. Then they feel guilty even if they leave for 5 minutes. My sister was taking care of her mother-in-law who had dementia and she was addicted to painkillers. And so in her support group in California, they said, "You've got to have a break. You can't just stay all the time with this woman." She would go out into the car when the nurses were there for 20 minutes. She felt guilty even being in the car, just for 20 minutes to read a book, take a little nap. So when you think of the level of guilt, we're really talking about beyond what a person who's not a caregiver.
Now, how do you address that? Obviously, that's a concern. How do you address the primary caregiver's feelings and problems that they develop?
What I do, like for guilt, let's say, what I say are there are two kinds of guilt. One kind of guilt is the guilt that's an alarm saying, like what happened to me is the irony of this whole situation, as I got towards the end of the 8 years of taking care of my husband, I was more debilitated, I was more tired, I was less patient, and so then I would lose my temper.
Right.
And so how I would deal with the guilt, and I felt guilty about it, was that was a wake-up call to me. And someone said to me, "I understand why you're losing your temper, but do you feel proud of yourself in your job as a caregiver? Losing your temper?" And she just asked. She wasn't judging me. She wasn't anything. And I realized from that day on, I never yelled again because I wasn't proud of myself kind of sinking into that. But there's another kind of guilt, the guilt that you're talking about, where the person can't leave the person alone, and it's almost like border. I wrote a book called Living on the Verge of Insanity taking care of my husband, and that kind of guilt is not, that's, it's way beyond. So then what you have to do is kind of get the person out of the situation a little bit to...
In the first part that you were describing, where you finally came out, but you must have realized up until that point, through 5, 6, or 7 years, you couldn't analyze your feelings in the sense of saying, I got to pull back or I got to do this myself?
I thought I was super caregiver.
Mm-hmm.
I just, and it is like when you look back on it now, that's kind of why I'm on a kick to do all this, because I think I'm pretty smart and I couldn't figure it out.
You couldn't figure it out?
Nope. Mm-hmm. Nope. It's really not something that the caregiver even should have to do. It's almost that the caregiver should be coaxed into an awareness of how difficult this job is, how appreciative the community is, and that we have to grow that appreciation so people understand what these caregivers are doing for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
If they weren't there, you'd have people with Alzheimer's driving cars all over the place. You'd have, you know, doing it. Because there would be no one to do it for them. You know, you'd have people who, you know, at the bank who are like in all sorts of states of debilitated health, you know, and so we're saved from all that because of caregivers.
Okay. So when the patient or the person gets out of the hospital or whatever, how does the primary caregiver know that this is a time when I should get in touch with a caregiver advocate?
Well, that's the idea of having the coaches in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we tell the people in the hospital is that this is a program that's open to the community.
Mm-hmm.
So if you need us once we're once you're home, you know, come back and we'll have someone here to talk to you. So it's kind of to grow those situations. And so before they get discharged, let them know that there's a link back to the hospital so that they would be able to come in.
But you have the hospital link. What about those who weren't connected with
the
hospital?
Well, that's the county then. Okay. So then the county you know,
does
yes,
that in, yeah. in terms of...
And, you know, you write articles, you have people write articles in the paper, this TV show, you know, there's so many ways that, you know, you try to get the word out. So then people say, oh, that I'm a little curious about that now. I never even thought of it that way. And then they'll start, you know, calling up the phone and trying out, you know, some of these programs and see if it's right for them.
Mm-hmm. Now, you can you identify the programs? Do you have names for the particular programs?
I call them, one would be like one-day events, and the one-day events are the education, where you're, you know, helping people to understand a topic.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the ongoing monthly support, which is the family wellness workshops. I'm creating gathering sites for caregivers to come together, and that's another kind of program where you and I can just sit here like this and talk. Why can't caregivers? So I'm looking for places for them to do that. And again, they do already have that at Northern Westchester Hospital, White Plains Hospital, Montefiore. So to have that be a broader, you know, advantage to caregivers that they would be, have a place that they could go and just have a cup of tea with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And then bringing programs to the, like, assisted living homes and senior. We have something called mobile respite, where you drop off your loved one in a recreation room, maybe at a senior center, and then the caregivers come in the other room, and we'll have a chance to, you know, support each other.
In your organization, how many people are we talking about with respect to patients or caregivers or however you... choose to count them.
In the 2 years that I've been doing this, in August I added up the numbers, but it's grown since then. But I was close to that. I've worked with 800 caregivers in 2 years.
Really?
And we've had, I think it was...
And each one of these caregivers is connected to one patient?
Yes. Oh, mm-hmm. Yes. And then I think it was 80 programs, something like that. So it was an average of 10 people per program. Some programs have 2 people, some people have 50 people, you know, but the average was about 10 people per program, whatever it was.
Now, do you network with the other hospitals and the community organizations, the county, for example?
I volunteer.
Uh-huh.
So I'm a volunteer county coach. I volunteer at Northern Westchester Hospital.
Yeah.
So I see how everything's run, and then I keep looking for opportunities to create similar
but
programs.
But I mean, do your associate in other groups have, do you have meetings, network meetings?
Yes.
Like that?
Yeah, we have an Alzheimer's Leadership Committee. We have the Caregiver Coalition for the county.
Yeah.
We have intergenerational, so that you get the young people taking care of the old people. And so you've got a whole wide, and I belong to all of them. I belong to the state. It's the New York State Caregiver and Respite Coalition.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been invited to come up to Albany to present, because Westchester is so advanced. we've been invited to present two of our programs to all, but to the whole rest of the state.
Which Why is Westchester so advanced compared to, say, Manhattan, New York City?
I don't know. We've just understood, maybe because we have to drive, you know, and that's a hard thing for caregivers and families to have to drive from place to place. And if their loved one can't drive anymore, like I know I was driving 2 hours a day just to bring my husband to a daycare center and back. No, I was driving 4 hours a day because an hour down, an hour back. So, and then I had to go pick them up. So, and there are vans that are available, but I think just Westchester is more spread out. So, and there are a lot of people here who really care about caregivers, and that's been great.
Mm-hmm. You know, so. Do you have any? Like lots of organizations, I have like sort of recognition. Do you recognize anybody who does anything special or in particular, or something that you want to bring? Somebody who's done something you want to bring to the public's notice?
Yeah, we do that through the state. They're having a contest right now for somebody who's helped caregivers, and there are other. You'll see. I'll get all the emails and say we're looking for someone to be voted to be the best caregiver or the story that is so touching, or someone who's taking care of caregivers. Mm-hmm. So yes, they definitely have those.
Now, a secondary caregiver, how much time does he or she spend a day, say, for example, with the patient?
It's really, in my mind, it's not really how much time, it's how much worrying. And somebody said to me the other day, I always have it in the back of my mind, 100% of the time. Mm-hmm. They say the secondary caregivers have 80% of the stress of the primary caregiver. Mm-hmm. So that's all, you're really running neck and neck there in terms of how much stress. It's worse that you can't be there. Mm-hmm. You feel impotent. You feel like you can't give. Right. So the guilt is even more sometimes for the secondary caregiver.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. The secondary, now I'm going to the tertiary. The son that you were talking about describing, would he be considered the secondary or the tertiary? The one that took his...
He would be secondary. Yeah, because he's watching out for the mom and the dad.
Okay.
Right. So he's secondary. Mom is primary.
Mm-hmm. And now, then, what would be the feelings incumbent upon the secondary, so, sort of like him, a mother or daughter or daughter-in-law? What types of feelings do they bring to the situation?
They can see the demise of the person who's doing the bulk of the caregiving, and the person who's doing the bulk of the caregiving is refusing to have any help. Mm-hmm. And again, they're feeling frustrated, they're getting annoyed, they're... Right. Feeling like, but mom, your blood pressure's so high. But mom, you were at the doctor's last week and he said your cholesterol, I'm worried about you.
Right.
So, but the problem is she's not asking for help and she's not allowing him to help. Caregiving has to be the person who wants to give the care and the person is able to receive the care.
Right.
Caregivers on that front are tough, they're a tough group.
Mm-hmm. That sounds like you have
it's very frustrating.
A tough job to fill because all the way down the line, feelings are involved,
yes.
Major feelings
that
you can't really overcome, that you have, that the person...
Well, you can change how you think about things, and that's something that I am constantly working with people. I don't change their mind for them, but I ask, have you ever thought of it this way? Or when I did it, I thought of it this way. So... And that's when I wrote my book. It was like sort of looking over my shoulder to say, how does someone else deal with this? Mm-hmm. I would make a plays with my husband. And so some of the crazy things he was saying would just be part of a crazy play. So just to relieve and make it fun. And, so then somebody could see that and say, oh, I'd like to do that too or something.
Well, Christine, this has been an education for me and I think for our viewers also. I'd just like to remind our viewers before we sign off that Rockland Psychiatric Center has community-based service locations here in Westchester County. Inpatient services are located in Orangeburg over in Rockland County. And thank you so much for being on our program. And you didn't give a number or anything, but maybe you'll come back again and exchange and give some more information for this very informational program.
Okay, good.
Thank you so
Thanks
much.
Thanks for having me.
With the City of Forest.